So we have with us tonight Kari, Rechtzigel, and Patricia Brocca. Kari is the executive director of the BBHT, and Patricia is in charge of licensure for LPCs and LPCCs. So they'll share with us the procedure to get licensed. For those of you who are joining us via webinar, please know that you can type your questions, and Laurentia will be reading the questions and transmitting them to our guests. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Well, good evening, everybody, here in the classroom with us and out there. As Solange said, my name is Kari Rechtzigel. I'm the actually the original executive director for the BBHT. It was established in 2003, and the first licenses were issued in 2004. So we've been issuing licenses for 10 years, and I'm still happy to be a part of it.
Okay, I'm Patricia Labraca. I'm the LPCC licensing coordinator. I've been with the Board of Behavioral Health and Therapy for just a little over a year. Prior to that, I had 17 years of experience working with the Board of Psychology in Minnesota. So similar, but different. And I'm happy to be with BBHT.
And we're very happy to have such an experienced person working for the office and for all of you. Now, I'm assuming everybody has a copy of the slides, and you know, hopefully they'll be made available to those participating electronically. Just a brief history and where you can go to find all the information that you need about licensure and regulation. Our statutes for LPC and LPCC licensure are Minnesota statutes section 148B.50 through 148B.593. There are also administrative rules in chapter 2150, and those rules are in four parts. There are rules about license renewals and termination of license, continuing education rules, supervised field experience and professional practice, and that's the really important supervision role. LPCCs. LPCCs are among the credentials in the Adult Children's Mental Health Act. They are a mental health professional license, and what this means is they mental health professionals have a scope of practice defined in the law, chapter 245, and in addition, related to reimbursement, they can get public reimbursement, social care, medical assistance, et cetera. So I wanted to say too, if you have a question along the way, it's fine if you raise your hand and we can stop and answer those questions, or we can wait to the end. I guess we're open to whatever. Sometimes I think it's good to address a question as it the topic unfolds.
First, we have information regarding the requirements for LPC licensure, a licensed professional counselor, which of course you need to have a master's or a doctoral degree in counseling or related field, and need to have a minimum of 48 semester credits to obtain licensure. You do need a total of 60 credits, but be licensed with a minimum of 48, and those additional 12 credits or however many you need to get to 60, you're given the first 4 years of licensure to obtain those additional credits. And you have to have 700 hours of supervised field experience, which I'm sure you do in your program here. And then the coursework in the 10 core counseling subject areas. And then the 2,000 hours of post-degree supervised practice, that is a requirement to have an LPC independent license, but you can get your LPC license prior to completing the 2,000 hours by submitting an approved supervision plan. And any supervised work experience that you get, your supervisor has to be approved by the board before that experience can count. Many people can be approved as supervisors, anyone with a mental health professional level license, an LICSW, an LMFT, an LP, LPCC can be approved supervisors. So, yes.
Sorry, so quick. So the individual needs to be approved before starts to count or the plan itself?
Yes, the question was, does the individual supervisor themselves have to be approved or just the plan? The supervisor has to be approved. They have to submit a supervisor application form showing that they meet our qualifications to be an approved supervisor. Now, sometimes you may have already started supervision, and it doesn't mean those hours can't count, but they, when we approve somebody as a supervisor, we actually approve them back to whatever date they met the qualifications. It's not the date they submit their application. So they could be approved, but if you want to know for certain before you start accruing hours, make sure that they get approved as soon as possible. You also, for LPC licensure in Minnesota, have to take the national exam, either the NCE, the National Counselor Examination, or the NCMHCE, the National Clinical Mental Health Counselor Exam. Either one of those are acceptable for LPC licensure in Minnesota. However, if you intend to go on for LPCC licensure, as of August 1st, 2014, the law changed, and anyone applying for LPCC licensure, either by the conversion method, meaning you get your LPC license first and then go on, or applying directly for LPCC, has to take the NCMHCE. So what I advise people, if you know LPCC is a license you're going to seek in the future, when you graduate, you go on to take the exam, take the NCMHCE right from the start. That's acceptable for both licenses. If you only take the NCE, then you will have to go back and take another exam at some point if you want to go on to LPCC. Those are the 10 core content areas of the education, and I'm sure that your program here at Adler pretty much follows that. And a lot of times, if you take coursework that isn't very, the title of the course or something isn't real clear that these areas were covered, but you had a course that you know covered these specific areas, you want to keep all your syllabi. That's very important. Not so much for when you apply for LPC licensure, it's pretty clear, but then when you apply for LPCC licensure and you have to show content area in the six additional clinical content areas, the syllabi will be required. The application and licensure committee at the board requires that you submit the syllabi, so hang on to them when they are done. Don't throw them out, keep them handy. You'll probably want to keep them for a very long time, because if you move to another state and apply for licensure there, they may also require that. Could be 10 years down the road, and then you're trying to dig up information on what your coursework really covered, and we have many people that struggle with that right now, so that's my advice.
Yeah, great.
Yes.
I usually tell students that they need, because the board requires the syllabus at the time they took the course, right? It's not the current syllabus being taught
right
at the school for that, so.
Exactly. Exactly. It's what the course was at the time that you took it. It could change, you know, 2-3 years from now, and then if you go back and you submit that syllabus, but it wasn't at the time you took the course, it could be different.
So, yeah, bottom line, the date on the syllabus has to match the date on your transcript as to when you took the course. And just one other thing I'd like to point out is many of the graduate programs have provided the board office with a listing of the courses they offer that line up with our requirements for licensure, but don't necessarily depend on that. It's still excellent advice to keep your own records. But it is helpful. It does speed the licensure process if you do have a grid for the state.
Yes. If a person already holds an LPC and they need to, and then they take the additional coursework, would they need to provide just the syllabi for the additional coursework? They would have, or would they have to create everything from?
No. If you obtain your LPC license and then you apply for the LPCC by the conversion method, when you submit that application, don't have to re-document the 10 core counseling subject areas. You will only have to document the 6 clinical subject areas and submit syllabi for that.
One thing too that you'll notice if you have reviewed both applications, there is some overlap. And those two overlapping areas are number 6, social and cultural foundations, including both cultural issues, and then number 10, professional counseling, orientation, ethics. Just as a bit of history, you might find that repetitive or whatever, but the licensing requirements for the LPCC license were the result of legislatively mandated study that was completed in 2007. And so in order for the board to succeed in legislation creating the clinical level, we had to adopt the findings of the task force report.
So basically what she's saying is, you know, some of the same coursework that you listed for your the 10 core content areas for LPC licensure or even on the LPCC general method app, you can use those same courses to meet some of the other content areas. They don't have to be different. These are the requirements for the LPCC general method. The general method is when you apply for the LPCC license directly, you don't obtain an LPC license first and then do the conversion. The LPCC license has basically a lot of the same requirements as the LPC with the master's or doctoral degree, the 48 semester credits, 700 hours of supervised field experience, and then of course 24 graduate level semester credits in the 6 clinical content areas. So you have to demonstrate specific, in the general method you would have to, there's certain like 6 credits in one area and 6 in another, and you would have to demonstrate that you had that coursework.
And just as a point of clarification, you see that the baseline number of semester credits is 48, and then there's the 24 graduate level semester credits. It doesn't mean that you have to take 24 more credits on top of the 48. What it means is that in the whole universe of all of the semester credits you've completed, you have to demonstrate that at least 24 of them match up with the 6 clinical content areas specified in the law.
Okay, and then the LPCC licensure requires 4,000 hours of post-degree supervised practice. The LPCC license can't be issued under a supervision plan or while you're working on that 4,000 hours. That can only be issued once you have completed them. So unlike the LPC license where you could get that under a supervision plan working on your first 2,000, LPCC license cannot be issued till you complete 4,000 hours, which equals approximately 2 years at full time work, and it can't be completed in less than 24 months, so you can't work 60 hour weeks to get it done sooner.
And just before I forget to say something, we often get the question at the board that the LPC license is going to be abolished or that it's not a valuable license, but I guess I would point this out for seeking employment. It may be beneficial to get the LPC license so that, you know, it's a regulated credential, it makes you more marketable. And of course, we at the board believe that licensed practice is, you know, preferable to unlicensed practice. It's our job is to protect the public and to make sure that people providing services have, you know, met some basic requirements, and licensure is one way of ensuring.
And I get that question all the time, and people will call and ask me, why should I get the LPC license? And I can't really answer that. You know, that's each individual's decision, whether you want to get that license and then go on, or you want to wait. It doesn't matter to me.
It's just, go ahead.
Yes. Oh, we have a question over
here. We have two, right?
Go ahead.
I was just wondering, if the LPC ever were removed, would we still have the option then to the LPCC
emergency? Yes, the question was, what if the LPC was ever to be abolished, would you still have the option for those holding an LPC license already to convert to the LPCC? Of course, that conversion won't go away, but I really don't foresee the LPC license going away either.
Yes, I would agree. There's absolutely no plan, never has been, for the LPC license to be eliminated. As I just said a couple minutes ago, one of the reasons is that the LPC license is ideal for new graduates. As they're coming out of school, you know, it's a way to get licensed because the new practitioner can be licensed with a supervision plan. Guidance until they complete that 2,000 hours that are required for that license. So I think it's a really vital license, even though sometimes through the grapevine people have misunderstood.
Yeah, I'm curious now with the LPC approach. Supervisor needs to be pre-approved by the board. Did I hear that correctly?
Right.
Okay.
For both licenses.
For both licenses. Okay, so if a LPCC says they are a licensed supervisor, what would I need to acquire from them to present so that my hours can count?
Okay, the question is, for somebody who is an approved supervisor and you intend to get your supervised practice hours for LPCC licensure through that person, do you need to submit something to the board to make sure that it's approved before you complete those? And no, you don't. If they're an approved supervisor, which on our website you can check, we have a supervisor lookup function on our website. You can, if you have the name of your supervisor, even if they say they're approved, you might want to go on there, plug their name in and check to see, or email me or call or something to make sure. But there is a supervision contract form available on our website that you and your supervisor can use for LPCC supervision, to make sure that your supervision is being conducted in the manner necessary to be able to count. But we don't want your plan for that. Until you apply for licensure, and once you complete it, then your supervisor would submit the verification forms verifying that you did complete everything. So it's basically, for LPCC licensure, up to you and your supervisor to logs, make sure it's being conducted in the right ratio. You need 2 hours of supervision for every 40 hours of work. That's not per week. If you work less hours, you know, it's two for every 40. So you have to make sure it's on you to make sure that it's your supervisor's approved, it's being conducted in the right way so that it can be accepted when you do apply.
Yes, I'd like to just add some additional information about the supervisor lookup online service on our website. If you're looking for a supervisor, you can also type in the name of a city. So if you searched on Minneapolis, you'd come up with hundreds of approved supervisors in the Minneapolis area. You can search by zip code. And also, when you select the name of a supervisor, it will come up with their approval information, and there's a key at the bottom explaining what types of licensure candidates that supervisor is accepted for.
Yes.
I want to know, for the LPCC, do it have to be an LPC supervisor for your hours to count?
For the LPCC hours, you want to know if the supervisor has to be an LPC approved supervisor?
LPCC.
LPCC. Not necessarily. If someone is qualified as an LPC approved supervisor, that means that they can supervise LPC applicants and licensees and people applying by the conversion method for the LPCC license. The only ones they can't supervise would be the LPCC general method applicants, those going directly for LPCC licensure. To obtain, or to be able to supervise that, they need to obtain the LPCC supervisor designation, and well, I won't get into what all the differences are. As far as what the supervisor qualification, Kari is the one that approves all the supervisor applications. But so a LPC designation means they can supervise LPCC conversion method applicants.
So
does that
answer your question?
Is that what you were asking?
Yeah, I was going to say, so you can't be supervised by anyone else but besides the person that holds your same license, right?
No. No, okay. The question was, go ahead, because I think you know
okay,
what she's asking.
When we give people designations like LPC supervisor, those people can be, they have to have a mental health professional level license. So in Minnesota, we accept LICSWs, LMFTs, LPs, licensed psychologists, or LPCs, or LPCCs. So it's not just people who have the license from our board. And Kari can explain the reason why we accept other mental health professionals.
Right. The reason that this board accepts other mental health professionals as licensure supervisors is that it was a brand new board. It was created in 2003, and our first licenses were issued in 2004, and so we did not have a pool of our own licensees to provide licensure supervision. So therefore, you know, we had to accept these other mental health licenses. If perhaps in the future we will move towards our own license professionals to supervise our licensees, but there aren't enough.
So as you see the two methods work, the general and the conversion method, do you see a benefit of going in one direction or the other for the professional? Or
no, it's okay. The question was between the LPCC general method or conversion method, if there's a benefit for someone to apply either way. The only thing is the conversion method, you know, someone can obtain the LPC licensure first if they want some kind of professional license to practice while they're working towards that 4,000 hours to become an LPCC. Because as I stated before, you can't be licensed as an LPCC until you complete 4,000 hours of post-degree supervised practice. So once you graduate and you take the exam and pass the exam, if you want to obtain a license sooner, you can get the LPC and then work towards the LPCC and file by the conversion effort. If you're working in a job where they don't require you to be licensed, they'll allow you to work and get your supervised practice, you really don't need to do the conversion. You can work for the 2 years that it takes to get your 4,000 hours and then do the LPCC general method. It's just each individual's own situation, what they want.
Yeah, there are actually some minor advantages to obtaining the LPC license first. And one of them is that in the 24 credits, the 6 clinical subject areas, it's different than the general method in that in those 6 areas, the LPCC conversion applicant does not have to show specified numbers of credits in those areas. They just have to show content. And one of the other advantages that just was passed into law on August 1st, 2014, is that if somebody obtains the LPC license first and completes 2,000 hours and has independent practice status, then they need only document the second 2,000 hours and 900 hours of direct client contact services. So they might seem minor as you read them, but it could be if you look at your coursework and you don't have 6 credits, you know, I don't know which slide there is. Yes. So for instance, if you didn't have 6 credits in diagnostic assessment for child or adult mental disorders, maybe you only have 4. Maybe you have 3. Just depends on your plan as you're completing your graduate studies and thinking about what licensure requirements are.
So just to reiterate that second one that was just passed in August of 2014, to have an independent practice status is a benefit because you said I just writing and listening.
Oh, okay. The question was, if somebody elects to get the LPC license and finishes the 2,000 hours of postmaster's supervised practice required by that license, it's a benefit in the conversion method because then the LPCC conversion applicant need only show the second 2,000 hours. So in other words, it's less paperwork for your supervisor. Instead of reaching, you know, back in time for beginning date of supervised practice, it's the second 2,000 hours, and then within that second 2,000 hours, 900 hours of direct client contact services.
Yes. So I'm working on art therapy, which is not licensed, and so I'm like kind of weighing the pros and cons of the various ones. And I'm just wondering, like looking at the 10 core content areas, like for example, I took multicultural art therapy. And I just wondered about how, what is the experience with you in looking at art therapists and you know, taking the, looking at the core content, you know, and saying, okay, well that'll count for this.
Yes, we license many people with art therapy degrees, especially in LPC areas. If you apply for LPCC licensure, then of course you would have to demonstrate somehow through our syllabi or whatever that there was a clinical component to that coursework to be accepted. But for LPC licensure, license many, many for art therapy degrees.
Thank
you. Considered a valid degree.
It's considered a related degree. And one thing I would point out in the LPC application itself, there is a coursework, what is it called, a coursework
guide.
And it's just a part of the application to assist applicants with figuring out what courses they took that would match up with the 10, with the 10 areas. And so, as I said, that's part of the LPC application. And the course doesn't have to have every single element, you know, listed in the coursework guide, but enough so that it aligns with what's required.
Yes.
All right. I've been around Adler long enough. I feel like I should know these answers, and I don't, since I'm here today. And I'm sorry for, but if you can just give me the step by step, I know it's so simple. For the simple answer to applying for LPC, so say I'm graduated,
yes,
got the diploma, LPC, the first thing to do is what? Go down and take the test.
Well, probably.
I just need steps 1, 2, 3. I just need to know what I need to do first, second, and third in order to, LPC allows me to practice independently.
If you've completed 2,000 hours of post-degree supervised practice, you can be an independent LPC license. Even if you're under supervision, I believe you still could practice independently, but you still need supervision as far as getting those 2,000 hours. But if you mean by practicing independently, like opening up your own little counseling,
yes,
practice or something, that's not prohibited once you have an LPC license, whether you're still under supervision or not. It is a valid license.
Right. It's just that your clients would need to be informed. For instance, if somebody went to our website and used the license verification function and put your name in, you'd either come up as supervised or independent if you had the LPC license. But getting back to your original question, what are the 1, 2, 3, 4 steps? First of all, it would be to complete your degree. Make sure you have 48 semester credits in it, 700 hours, you know, all those basic education requirements. Then the next thing to do is to contact the National Board of Certified Counselors, LPCC, arrange to sit for the exam. I'm sorry, I will slow down. We do this every day, and so. Okay, so, and Pat, jump in any time here, because it's your fit. Anyway, the first step, of course, is to complete your degree. And so, let us know if you're ready for the next step.
Step two.
Okay, for step two, is there any kind of like study guide or online practice tests that you can take?
You guys brought us a sample test, didn't you?
Oh, I know where that is.
We're asking if there's any study guides or practice tests for the national exam. And no, the board doesn't have any information like that, but I believe LPCC does have some study materials. Somebody just told me last week in a phone call, they said that I should let people know that if anyone's on LinkedIn, there's some way to link up with people who have study materials for the exams. I'm not on LinkedIn, I'm not real savvy with that, so I don't know how you would find that, but they said they found help through LinkedIn with people who have had study materials and helped them study for the exam, and it was very beneficial and helpful to them. So that's another way. Also, MINCA, the Minnesota Counseling Association, I've heard that, you know, they have like a Facebook page, and you know, you can link with people on that to find out, you know, if there's study materials around, but the board doesn't provide that at all, so sorry.
Okay, well, just can I add
Yes, certainly.
So if you're a member of ACA, ACA has a publication called Counseling Today, and there are many study guides advertised on Counseling Today. I always leave my old Counseling Today issues on the tables back there, so you can peruse that too.
Okay, you have a question back there about the exam?
No, it's not about the exam. I'm just curious, do you have any sense as the board about the prospects for LPCCs becoming eligible for Medicare? Do you have a crystal ball?
Okay, the question is, does the board have any information about LPCCs becoming qualified to receive reimbursement through Medicare? Well, first of all, the board is the licensing and regulatory entity in Minnesota, and so employment and reimbursement issues are outside of our duties and responsibilities. So we really don't, you know, have an official position on it. We don't have a lot of information on it. So I would direct you to the national organizations, the American Counseling Association, even the Minnesota Counseling Association, and perhaps the National Board for Certified Counselors.
Okay, thank you.
We're looking for number two.
Okay.
After number one.
Yeah.
Okay, number two was the exam. First of all was the degree.
And then
second item is making arrangements to take and pass the national exam, and we do recommend the National Clinical Mental Health Counseling Exam.
The National Mental Health
Okay, and Pat, what would you say the third step would be, selecting a supervisor?
Well, yeah, if you are looking for a job, yes, you need to have a job or some kind of experience working and finding a supervisor who is board approved before you begin that. It doesn't need to be a paid job, even if you volunteer work, but if you have the appropriate board approved supervisor, and it's important to make sure that they do meet the qualifications before you start training practice so that you know it will count. So then if you plan to apply for the LPC license, you've taken the exam, passed the exam, you found work, you found a supervisor, you can submit your application. That will be the next step.
Okay, and just, I'm going to stop at this point. Sometimes people don't have a job, but what they will do is find somebody on the approved supervisor list, and so they'll submit a supervision plan with
right.
that person, and they'll say supervision, you know, and it asks you on the plan about the date that supervision is going to begin. And so if you're in that position, if you don't have a job, but you have found a supervisor and you want to submit the plan, just list the date of supervision is going to begin upon employment. And we can issue a license. And then if you have a plan, change in the plan, you have to notify us within 30 days, and that's spelled out in the supervision rules. If you want to change supervisors or, you know, any kind of a plan change. So that would be step number three, is find yourself an approved supervisor. Okay, questions about steps one, two, and three?
Can you start your supervised 2,000 or 4,000 hours before you pass that exam?
Yes.
Good question.
Okay. That was my
question. The question was, can you start your supervised practice hours, 2,000 hours, before taking the exam? Yes, you can begin your supervised practice as soon as you receive your degree.
Okay.
So it's post-degree, and you can start working, then you can work and do the exam. So it's your own personal preference.
Right, you can start accruing hours the day after your degree is over. Literally the next day.
So you wouldn't, I'm sorry.
Yes, go ahead.
So you wouldn't have to have a supervision plan in place before prior to starting.
No. You don't need the supervision plan submitted to us prior to beginning supervised practice. You do need to submit that with your LPC application. And so then you'll want to make sure that you have an approved supervisor. But you can start your supervised practice as soon as you graduate without notifying us. You don't need to know what you're doing or anything, as long as you're certain it's going to be acceptable and meet the requirements, and then you submit your application whenever you're ready to submit your application, and then submit the supervision plan. So you don't even have to apply until you complete the 2,000 hours if you don't want to, and then submit the or have your supervisor submit verification that you already completed the 2,000 hours.
That's correct. And the way for you to make sure that it's going to count is to look at that application itself, and you and your supervisor should look at the forms that person is going to have to sign, verifying that you've completed the 2,000 hours in the manner required by the board. So it's kind of like going to the very end, working backwards. So when you start out, look at that verification of completion of the supervision plan, or verification of what completion of the supervised practice.
Yes,
that's for the general.
You brought up a copy of the LPCC supervision contract, which is found on our website under miscellaneous forms, I believe it is now. It hasn't been on there, but I made sure it was put on there. And that's a contract if you're planning to work towards LPCC licensure. It says on the very first instruction line, do not submit this form to the board. This is a form for just you and your supervisor to go over, discuss, and make sure that your supervision is being conducted in accordance with these requirements so that you know there won't be any problem with it. So that is for the LPCC license. Is it just for general method?
It is.
Okay. But it's not a form that you submit. It's not like the supervision plan for the LPC license. That's something different. Because as I said, the LPC license can be issued before you complete your supervised practice. When you first begin it, you can get that license. LPCC license cannot be issued until you complete 4,000 hours of supervised practice. Is that clear?
Yes, I just took a look at this form, and I can tell you kind of the history of where the LPCC supervision requirements in the statute came from. They were fashioned after the supervision rules that were first written for LPCs. So I would say this is a guide. It will probably work for the LPC license as well, and the LPCC conversion, but this contract form was designed for the LPCC general method. But I believe that the ratios are the same as far as 2 hours of supervision for every 40 work hours. One of those hours has to be individual, the other group. 75% of the supervision has to be in person, 25% will be by electronic means. So those things come across all the licenses. So this would be an acceptable guide
to make sure your supervision is being conducted in the correct way so that there's a greater chance for it to be approved when you do apply. Yes?
Can I ask, is there any deadline in terms of years after I complete my master's in which I need to complete the supervised hours, the test, or the additional 12 credits that you were talking about?
If you want to repeat the question, it's actually three questions.
Yeah, well, I'm just trying to figure out.
Yes, he's asking if there's any deadline once you graduate to, that you have to complete the supervised practice, the exam.
Or I think you're talking about the additional 12 credits.
Or the additional 12 credits. And no, there is not. You can begin at any time. When you begin your supervised practice, there are requirements for it. It can't be, like for LPC licensure, that first 2,000 hours can't be completed in less than 12 months and no more than 36 months. For LPCC licensure, the requirement is the 4,000 hours can't be completed in less than 24 months and no more than 72 months. So that's a requirement, but as far as, you know, when you take the exam or any of the other requirements, the additional 12 credits, like I said, if you take them before you apply for licensure, great. You can be licensed with a minimum of 48. If you have up to 60, then you won't need any additional grad credits once you're licensed. But we do give you that first four-year period of licensure to obtain those additional 12 credits if needed, or however many. And the thing is with LPC, if you obtain LPC licensure, and you have the four-year period to get the grad credits, but somewhere in that period you transition and apply for LPCC and convert to that license, the 4 years start all over again. So you can have quite a few years to obtain the additional graduate credits needed.
Right, so that's, I guess, now that you mentioned that, Pat, that is then another advantage of getting the LPC license, you know, for your marketability, and then if you want to start on the additional credits to get up to 60, you know, that's a positive. And then if you do convert, as Pat said, then the continuing education cycle starts all over again with that new license. So theoretically, somebody could stretch it out to 8 years if they timed it as, you know, as such, you know, get the LPCC license right before you're due to report your continuing.
Another question here?
Yes, you. So it's kind of an extension of what he asked, but if I graduated and took the test and then didn't complete the hours, or didn't start working on the hours, does that start a time clock or no?
Question.
No, the question is if she graduates and takes the exam, but then does not start practicing or giving supervision for a period of time, that's fine. The exam results do not expire. We can keep them on file for years. Of course, your degree doesn't expire, so no. You can begin your supervised practice whenever you want to begin that, and that starts that 12, 36 month or 24, 72 month time period for completing it. Questions related to that?
How are we doing on how much time do we have?
It's 6:20.
Are there any other questions regarding the steps to licensure? You kind of went back and forth on these slides, but we do have a handout with just the basic information.
Patricia, the handouts, the copies that I made after we started somehow tucked some of the slides from the back. So I will make copies later and get them for whoever makes copies.
And of course, hopefully you're all familiar with our website and have been visiting our website. I know there's a lot of information on there. It's sometimes a little bit hard to navigate through, but if you go on there and just look through it, read things, look at the applications themselves, that gives you a lot of information. And everything is really spelled out there on the website, and once you kind of understand, it might make a little more sense when you go back and look at it now. And then if you have you know, particular questions, the best way to reach me is through email. I brought cards and it has my email address on it. My phone calls, if anyone's ever tried to call and reach me and constantly gets the voicemail full message, I really apologize. It's very difficult to keep up on those phone calls. It fills up very fast. It's much easier to email. I can respond usually within a, you know, 2-3 days, sometimes even faster, to email questions. So.
Right, and then you can also email me. And then if we do have to have a meeting or a phone call, then if you email us, we can schedule that.
And we'll
set up a time to do that.
Excuse me. We also have open walk-in hours on Tuesday and Thursday afternoons from 1 to 4. We've set aside those times to guarantee that either myself or Kari will be available to talk to anyone coming in with questions on LPC, LPCC licensure. Samantha, who does the LADC licensing, is also available for questions on that licensure. You don't need an appointment. If you can come in, just come on in. We take you first come, first base, or first, well, you know what I mean.
Is there a line out the door?
And answer your questions personally, which sometimes helps, you know, versus trying to communicate on phone or email. You can also come in at other hours if you're not available, preferably by emailing and making sure that my schedule or Kari's schedule is free, that we can also meet with you. We're open Monday through Friday, 8 to 4:30 every day. We are a state office, but setting aside those particular hours guarantees you'll be able to meet with someone.
Could we get your cell phone numbers?
Yeah, sure.
The question was if we're going to give up our cell phone numbers.
Yeah.
No, we do have to have a leg outside of the beach.
And my best questions come up at 3 a.m.
Email.
I do get requests from people, applicants or licensees, to link on LinkedIn and things like that. And you know, I'm of a different generation, and I'm really not savvy with all of that social media and LinkedIn and Facebook. So sorry.
And one other thing.
Connect with you that way.
Right. One other thing with those, with Facebook, LinkedIn, etc. I mean, certain of the information you provide to us in the licensure process is private data on you, and we can't talk about certain things depending on what it is. So
that's one thing I heard from Minka is, you know, they have a Facebook page and people will go on there and post all kinds of things about their experience with us at the board, or particular information, their difficulties they're having with their application or whatever, and you know, we can't go on there and respond to that information, because once you do apply, the data practice, the government data practices does take over, and certain information is considered private. So if somebody's having particular issues with their individual application, I can't go on Facebook and respond to what those issues are for everybody to see. You know, it's private data. So, but, you know, you're welcome to contact me personally and I can help you through any issues or questions. I'm very responsive to helping people through and explaining things. Sometimes it does make it much more easier to explain things up front rather than have to deal with problems later and people get frustrated. So don't hesitate to contact me or email me and I'll get back to you. Yes.
I'm feeling like we've missed. I'm wondering if we should go back and make sure that we've
covered everything. Well, that's all the other things we
and
do.
What I'm thinking of specifically is I think we made it past general method requirements and the credits. Conversion method. Is everybody comfortable with this information about the conversion method.
There was a lot of misinformation out there prior to the statute changing August 1st that people thought the conversion method was going away forever, and that is not the case. There were some changes made in the conversion method. One of the biggest changes that affects people is the exam requirement. Prior to August 1st, if someone had gotten licensed as an LPC and had only taken the NCE and then converted, the NCE would have been acceptable. They could convert to the LPCC. After August 1st, everyone applying for LPCC, whether the conversion or the general method, has to take the NCMHCE, the clinical exam. And that's why I recommend to people to take that right away so that you don't have to end up taking two exams down the road.
Yeah, and the second major change was that the previous conversion method only required 4,000 hours of post-master's supervised clinical practice that was acceptable to the board. And now, as of August 1st, like the general method, conversion applicants have to show those direct client contact hours. So those are the two big changes. The major advantage to the conversion method still remains in the coursework area, in that there, as you can see in the middle of the slide, no minimum credits per area. That's the major advantage that remains. Question?
I was just wondering, can you take the test if you're still in school, if you have 48 semester hours done?
No. I believe MBCC requires you to submit a sealed transcript showing your master's degree before you can take the exam. So you have to have your degree conferred.
Right. That the question was whether you could take the exam before, I believe you said if you had completed 48 semester credits. And the MBCC sets the requirements for who can sit for the exam. And so then, as Pat said, sealed transcript showing that your degree has been conferred.
And that's one thing, speaking of transcripts, one thing I'd like
to
reiterate, you know, when you apply for the exam, you can submit your sealed copy of your own transcript to them. When you're applying for licensure with the board, that's not acceptable. The transcript has to be sent to us directly from the school. And same with the exam results, they have to come directly to us from NBCC. We don't accept a copy in your application. The verification of your completed supervised practice has to come directly from your supervisor, not submitted with your application. Those are the main problem areas that hold up people's applications. So, another question?
So just to recap that, the three main roadblocks to completing the licensure process are not having your transcript sealed from your school, not having your results sealed from the examiner,
sent from
the examiner, and not having your completed supervised hours sent from your supervisor. Those are the three.
Right. Again, those are the three main areas that hold up somebody's application, is not having the transcript sent directly from the school, not having the exam results sent directly from MBCC. If you take the exam at a Minnesota test site, they will automatically transmit the results to us electronically. They're sent the month following when the exam was given, so November results I'll get first week of December. If you take it at your school or some other place, you will have to request that they send us a copy. It's only if you take it at the Minnesota test sites, we will automatically transmit those results.
And then
electronically.
And then just to touch on the third item, that verification of supervised professional practice, those forms are signed by the supervisor and must be mailed directly by the supervisor to us. Now, having said that, once Pat reviews those verification forms, I would say that is the number one issue that holds up or prolongs the licensure process is that those forms are submitted with incorrect, incomplete information. And so
what
we've tried changing the forms, but we can't change the law. So those verification forms are created directly from elements in the law. They should not be crossed out, altered, anything like that, left blank. So that is why we recommend at the very beginning of supervised practice, the supervisee and the supervisor review that form that's going to ultimately have to come in. That's, I think, the best way to prevent these delays.
And I spend a great many hours scanning those forms, sending them back to applicants, telling them to return them to their supervisor because something's not filled out correctly. I think a lot of people will, as an applicant, you will take that form and you can fill it out and put down the dates your supervision began and ended and the number of hours and the total hours and all of that. But if you don't fill it out correctly and then you give it to your supervisor, I believe a lot of supervisors will just go through and initial it, sign it, and send it off to us without looking at it, reviewing it. So it's going to hold up your application if you're filling that information out for them and asking them to sign it, make sure you fill it out correctly, make sure they review it. It's on the supervisors too, they shouldn't just sign something that you put in front of them without looking at it, but that is a real problem and causes a lot of delays in issuing people's licenses. And we only issue licenses on the first of the month. So if we get an application and, everything looks good, we have your exam results, we have your transcript, we have everything, but there's a problem on the supervision form, that's gonna delay because I'm sending it back to you. You have to send it to your supervisor. They have to correct it, send it back to me. That could delay you getting licensed by another whole month. If it's towards the end of the month, I don't get it back, then it's gonna have to wait till the next month. So.
Right, and we don't accept fax. We need original signatures on those forms also. So no fax and no photocopies.
Spent a good deal of time on that, talking about exams. Are there any questions on either supervision or exams?
So then what happens?
Well, as I said, we only issue licenses on the first of the month, so depending on when applications are received, when everything is done and complete and approved, then your license can be issued. People will submit their applications, and you do have to pay the application fee, the $425 right away. Your check is cashed right away because the state auditors do not allow us to hold checks. So people will assume when their check is cashed right away that their license is going to be issued right away. That's not always the case.
It's hardly ever the case.
Yeah.
And the reason being, the reason being is that we receive applications every day.
Yes.
So they are deemed complete. So people who do a really nice job of getting everything accurate the first time around, they might get licensed faster than somebody else who doesn't.
And my goal is to license everyone. I want to see you all licensed and out there doing your thing. You've spent many years and lots of time obtaining your degree and your education, and we're not here to prevent people from getting licensed. Our job is to license you. So, I'll work with you as much as I can. I do have hundreds and hundreds of applicants, and I'm juggling LPCs and LPCCs. In addition to after your license, I deal with renewals and continuing ed.
And we have hundreds of it would be interesting. I don't know how many approved supervisors we
carry through this in there to show, We have a small staff. We have 5 people in our office. And so there's just a lot of stuff going on, and you know, we're very busy, but we do want to get you licensed. And so the more that you can help yourselves by doing things correctly and making sure that everything's submitted that needs to be submitted, it would be much easier for all of us.
And I think the point of this slide is that, you know, we're not just a licensing board, we're a regulatory board. And so issuing initial licenses and renewing licenses is not the only thing that we do. And that's what that's about.
So let's see, I think if anyone's interested in like about the board itself, you know, as it says, we have 13 members. There's 5 LADC, licensed alcohol and drug counselor members, 5 LPC, LPCC members, and then 3 public members. They're all appointed by the governor. We have quarterly board meetings, but the board's committees, the application and licensure committee, which I work with, meets as often as necessary they review a lot of the LPCC applications. The board staff, myself and Kari, have been delegated authority by the board to approve the LPC applications ourselves so that they can be issued faster. But then Kari also works with the Complaint Resolution Committee, which deals with complaints that come in on licensees, the legislative committees.
Very specific questions. One is, there's reference to adult and children in the 4,000 hours for LPCC. Do we have to have both?
Experience with both.
Okay.
Yes. The LPCC licensure can't be issued unless you had experience with both children and adults. And that's another area that sometimes causes issues. If someone's working strictly with adults and they say, well, I haven't had experience with children. Well, if you've done any kind of family services working with those adults, and maybe the families and any children under the age of 18, that can be counted as services for children. There's no minimum amount of hours that you have to have services to either or. If you've done, you know, 1 or 2 hours worth of work with children, then your supervisor could verify that you did have work with children. And that's required by the Adult and Children's Mental Health Act?
Well, I think that the history of that requirement to have services to both adults and children is that mental health professionals are defined in the law in each of those mental health. And so in order to have the mental health professional level license, the person has to have experience both. And so it's, you know, the idea being that some people choose to have a practice with children. Some might have choose to practice someone with adults and some combination. And that's why there's no strict hour amount. But it's a legal, I guess, requirement, you know, just as the way I explained it, because mental health professionals are defined in both of those.
And being close to Wisconsin, I'm sure a supervisor would have to know this, but is there a, can one do work on either side and have it accrued towards the $4,000 for LPCC?
The question is, does location, correct, of supervised practice. I mean, I guess what you're asking is, in order for practice hours to count, do they have to occur in Minnesota?
The answer to that would be no, not necessarily. The main thing is your supervisor has to be approved. They don't necessarily have to be licensed in Minnesota either. They could hold a mental health professional level license in another state, but they would have to submit our supervisor application and meet the same requirements as any supervisor in Minnesota. But you can count supervised practice hours in other states if it's done according to our statutory requirements. Yes?
And this is piggybacking off that, and it may not make sense, but does that only apply to states that have reciprocity of Minnesota for LPC?
Not necessarily. Your license in Minnesota doesn't allow you to practice in other states.
Right.
It only allows you to practice in Minnesota. We do have reciprocity with certain states coming from other states where we can license people if they've met certain requirements. I can't tell you if Minnesota license is accepted in other states. That's up to them. But when you're practicing under supervision, you know, like in Minnesota, obviously you can be accruing practice hours without being licensed under supervision. I mean, you need to get, I don't know if other states have a law against that. That's up to that state, but we accept, you know, if you accrued hours in another state and met our requirements and your supervisor was approved, we would accept it. But
right. So the reciprocity issue with respect to supervised practice is really, we don't have any regulations specifically addressing it. I guess as Pat said, the most important thing is that the supervisor's approved and that the supervised practice is conducted in accordance with Minnesota's requirements. So no, we'll take supervised practice. And he's, we've even had people practicing abroad. You know, when that comes, even if it's in another country, provided that the supervisor's approved.
And we have people who have been licensed in some other state who apply by reciprocity to Minnesota. But if they're, our application and licensure committee will look at, if it hasn't already been looked at, they'll look at that state's requirements to see if they're substantially similar to ours before they'll approve the reciprocity. But some states don't. Their requirements are different. They might require less supervised practice hours or different exams or whatever. So then those people, in order to get licensed here, if they can't do it by reciprocity, have to fill out the regular application, meet the same requirements. But, you know, their supervision was all done in their other state. So if their supervisors in that other state are willing to fill out the application and meet our requirements so that it can be counted, then they don't have to come here and start all over again. And I'm assuming a lot of states it's the same, I would hope.
Right, and on our website, probably doesn't apply to any of you in this room, but for people moving into Minnesota, we have on our website a list of the states whose licenses have been approved for reciprocity in Minnesota. And there are more LPC states, we have more states approved for reciprocity for the LPC license than we do for the LPCC license. Our LPCC license is unique, I think. Very few states can meet our requirements for reciprocity for an LPCC license. And I think that's because of the way those requirements were created. And again, it came out of a task force report from 2007.
So it's not our fault.
And that's the other thing. Sometimes applicants think that the staff has created the requirements and the law, and now we have to follow it just as you do.
Are there
anything else on the
other questions, or were there questions from our webinar?
Yep. We're going to go ahead and check now. So
okay.
Are you advancing to the other side, or?
Go to the last one.
Well, this again explains our website. If you haven't visited it, please do. There's a lot of information on there. Like I said, I know it's not organized real well. When we changed to a new website, it just had to get put on there. And someday, when I have very little to do, I will try to get that reorganized. But okay. So
we have six people there. There's a few questions. Would you like to make a change?
Yeah.
Scroll down.
Possibly, if you've been getting supervision by a board-approved supervisor.
So you just have to make sure that your supervisor is a board-approved supervisor.
Correct.
Well,
now that a school counseling
has to be clinical practice.
Well, wouldn't that count for LPC license, but not necessarily LPCC?
Correct, but I heard the reference to 4,000 hours, and here's what I would say. It's possible the scope of practice is very broad, but here's what it says about clinical practice in Minnesota Statutes What it says is under supervision, the supervised practice must be clinical practice. And so what that means is, it goes on to say, supervision includes the observation by the supervisor of the successful application of professional counseling knowledge, skills, and values. Okay, and here's where it gets to be clinical. In the differential diagnosis and treatment of psychosocial function, disability, or impairment, including addictions and emotional, mental, and behavioral disorders. So depending on what the school counselor is doing in that practice, could be clinical, might not. So that's what's, you know, and so the staff can't tell you yes or no, it'll count. Our suggestion is that you talk with your licensure supervisor about the duties that you're performing and see if it falls within the clinical practice description.
We've had occasion where applicants have applied, and based on where they're working, what type of job they're doing, the committee has asked for a copy of their job description to make sure that it have, you know, clinical content in their job or what they're doing.
And if I get the LPC first, where there is no split between clinical hours and other hours, so if I'm understanding the question,
how is it split for those additional hours? I think this person is asking the difference between the two models.
Right, and really, there isn't the requirements are this: 2,000 hours of professional supervised practice for the LPCC, 4,000 hours of supervised professional practice for the LPCC. And so for that LPCC license, what the requirement is that at least 1,800 of those 4,000 hours have to be in those direct clinical services to clients. Now everybody knows that when you're working, you're not seeing clients 100% of the time. And so other things, you get to count other things that you do, like staff meetings or paperwork that you do, progress notes, reports that you write. That's all part of your practice, because you have to do those things. So I don't know if I can explain it any better than that if you want to say something.
Well, I really didn't quite understand the question, so.
I think they were asking about the split difference in the hours required, and so.
Well, the 2,000 for the LPC license and 4,000 for the LPCC. The first 2,000 hours documented for LPC licensure, your supervisor does not have to document how many of those were direct client contact members.
Right.
For LPCC licensure, as Kari said, out of that 4,000 hours, if they have to document 1,800 hours of direct client contact. Except if they've got an LPC independent license with that 2,000 hours has already been done, completed, verified, then only 900 hours of the remaining 2,000 have to be direct client contact.
And I want to, right, and I want to read the text from the statute on the conversion method that was just adopted August 1 of 2014. Because it is, I think, possible to complete 2,000 hours of practice if it wasn't necessarily clinical. So what it says in Minnesota Statutes 148B, 5301, Subdivision 4, and then it would be Item 8, has demonstrated to the satisfaction of the board successful completion of 4,000 hours of supervised postmaster's degree professional practice in the delivery of clinical services in the diagnosis and treatment of child and adult mental illnesses and disorders. So the requirement is 4,000 hours, and the supervisor is going to have to sign off on that. Both at the LP, if the first 2,000 hours is going to count, it does have to be clinical practice. So that's what they were looking for.
Do I need the LPC license if I am planning to go into a career counseling at a university?
The question is, does somebody need an LPC license to do career counseling at a university? There are exceptions to licensure, and one of the practice settings that's exempt from the licensure requirement is, I believe, educational institutions. I believe, I can tell you, don't get this one very often. The exceptions to licensure are found in Minnesota Statutes Section 148B.592 and in Subdivision 3 is government agencies and educational institutions. So that is one practice setting for which licensure is not required. It could be a condition of the employer. The educational institution might say, we prefer that you're licensed, but by law, and the exceptions to licensure, I would have to say no, it's not required.
As a clinical supervisor for LPCCs, this person's interested in having access to this video that we're doing for the webinar for the supervisees and wants to know if we're going to have a link provided in the future. So I think you have said that you would allow us to do that.
Yes.
That's correct.
So that's yes.
The question is if our presentation here tonight is going to be available to what, both supervisors and supervisees?
Yes, because he's saying he would like to be able to give his supervisees access to the webinar footage.
Right, and so my understanding is that Adler Graduate School would provide the link. Mm-hmm. Yes.
For the LPCC track at Adler, we take 60 credits to graduate. Can we still do the LPC conversion after having completed the additional 12?
Well, if I'm understanding the question, Adler program requires 60 credits for graduation. So if you've already got 60 credits, whether you're applying for LPC licensure or LPCC, you won't be required to get any additional graduate credits after licensure. Nobody is required to have more than 60 credits. So if you come in and apply for licensure with 60 credits already having been obtained in your degree program, you will not be required to do any additional graduate semester credits. You will be required to do the regular 40 hours of continuing education units, but not any graduate semester credits. Nobody's required to do more than 60.
That's right. The only instance I can think of where somebody would have to complete additional graduate credits is if they didn't meet the coursework requirements, and if the staff and the committee identified a deficiency in the coursework requirements, then that person would have to go back and complete graduate work in a specified area.
I think what the person is asking is, can they still use the conversion method?
Oh, yes.
Yes, while they're in that track, and it sounds to me like
right. The number of credits has nothing to do with what licensure method the person selects.
Right. So they could still apply for the LPC license first and then convert to the LPCC.
Right, and so I think where a lot of people get confused is in the baseline number of credits it takes to get licensed. It's 48 semester credits for both the LPC and the LPCC license. And some people, as it looks like Adler has set up their program so that people just can finish all 60 credits. There are other programs that do not, and people can quit at 48 or 50, 52, whatever they want. And so those additional 12 are not a requirement for licensure. They are a continuing education requirement.
These people want to know how they can access the PowerPoint, perhaps by email, and I think that would be for you.
Well, no, they can access through the webinar, right? It's the same person. It will be available the way you said.
Okay.
Through the Adler library.
Yeah.
Okay, so the question is how people can access the slides from our presentation tonight. And it's my understanding that the link that Adler Graduate School provides will show all of the slides that we used to present this information this evening.
That was
the
question.
Thank you so much.
You answered all the questions.
Any other